So now that we have some experience with square roots of negatives and the introduction of this imaginary unit I, this now means that circumstances where we end up with a negative underneath the square root symbol while solving a problem is no longer a showstopper. So if we take the first example here, we have I squared plus 4 equals 0. Hopefully we're not baited into the idea that we can factor this expression. There's no way to factor a sum of squares. So our only option is to isolate the square and then take the square root of both sides. So I'm going to subtract 4 from both sides and then get x squared equals negative 4. So now we take the square root of both sides, and so we get x on the left. Now on the right-hand side, we need the plus or minus since we're taking the square root of both sides of an equation. And so then I need to simplify this root negative 4 by taking the negative root negative 1 and separating it from the root 4. So we've got x equals plus or minus. Hopefully we know that this equals I times, and then the square root of 4 is 2. So we can clean this up and write it as x equals plus or minus 2i. So we're getting two answers, as we would expect, for a problem that has squared as the highest exponent. But these two answers are imaginary because we had to solve by taking the square root of a negative. In the next example, here we have another expression that involves x squared, but we're not going to be able to solve using square roots like we did on the previous example, since we have this extra x term in there. So we can't factor. There's nothing that multiplies to make 9 and adds to make that 2. So we're either going to have to use the quadratic formula, or I'm going to opt for completing the square. So I'm going to subtract 9 from both sides, so then I get that negative 9 on the other side. And so this is where we have to figure out what number we're going to add to both sides of the equation in order to make this left-hand side factorable. So that technique is to take half of the b value, so negative 2, divide it by 2, and then square it. So negative 2 divided by 2 is negative 1, negative 1 squared is 1, so I'm going to add 1 to both sides. So that makes this left-hand side factorable. That's what I wanted. I want it to factor into the same thing twice. And so if you'll recall, it's x and then half of whatever this number is before you square it. So I've got x minus 1 squared equals, now on the other side, I just have negative 9 plus 1, so negative 8. And so now we're at the point where we can use our square roots one more time. So I can take the square root of both sides. I'm left with x minus 1 over here on the left equals, and then I've got plus or minus, and then again, I'm going to separate the root negative 1 from the 8. And so over here, I've got a little simplifying to do, 4 and 2, 4 can come out from underneath the square root symbol. So I'm looking at x minus 1 equals plus or minus. Now again, that root negative 1 is I, and then times 2 root 2. Or if I wanted to clean that up a little bit, plus or minus 2i root 2 would be a little bit better way to write that. And so then my last step is to just add 1 to both sides. But that, of course, is not a like term with 2i root 2. So I'm just going to leave my answer as 1 plus or minus 2i root 2. And so we've got two answers once more, 1 plus 2i root 2 and 1 minus 2i root 2. So our answers are complex. They have a real and an imaginary part to them in this case.